Welcome back, troglodytes, to your daily dose of guitar information, the Trogly's Guitar Show. This past weekend at Heritage Auctions, there was a few guitars auctioned off from Trini Lopez's estate. And a few of them were kind of interesting modern prototypes, and he also had a few stage-played guitars. So let's go ahead and take a look at a few of these and see what they ended up selling for. Starting off here, we have the one that he's mainly known for, the basically a 335 but converted to be a little bit different. You have the Trini Lopez badge down here with the trapeze style setup, kind of like an early 70s, late 60s ES-335, but instead of an F-hole, it's diamond shape, and that's the whole Trini look right here. And of course we get the split diamond inlays and the Firebird headstock on one of these things. A lot of the current generation actually associates this shape with Dave Grohl because Dave Grohl adopted Trini's signature guitar as his own and just kind of changed it up a little bit as far as finishes go. But this was one of the reissue prototypes done up in 2013. So not one of the new ones, but still fairly modern, so not even vintage. Interestingly enough though, mint condition, no serial number. It was likely a gift from Gibson to him, trying to design a new signature model production run. But kind of strange that they didn't have any type of serial number on here. But what did this one sell for? $17,500. And it looks like a phone bidder got that one, but if you want to buy it from him, that's what's kind of nice about this website, is I think to cut down on people calling them going, hey, who bought this? They actually kind of give you a second chance right here, and they say, hey, if you want to make it worth this guy's time to sell this to you, we're going to broker this deal right here if you want to pay $26,000 or more for it. Now, that might seem kind of ridiculous when this just sold yesterday, but say in 5 or 10 years somebody's looking through these old auctions, it can be useful. I think they charge a huge premium. Okay, maybe it's not as bad as I remember, or they've modified this recently. $40 minimum or 10%, whichever's greater. Which in this case, it's like $2,500, so it's quite a bit, but hey, they're brokering the sale. Next up, you have the model that not a lot of people know about. This is one of those models that I find quite fascinating because you never see these things out there and they're not all that expensive. But check this out. Double cutaway, sharp Florentine style. It almost looks like a lefty Rickenbacker. Because normally on a right-handed guitar, this horn is slightly larger, but it's the opposite on this. But to match the diamond F-holes that are bound on this one, they've got this weird diamond-shaped pickguard. As far as the tailpiece setup, very similar. Same style of inlays, it looks like they're maybe a little bit further apart. But what I really appreciate about this is the headstock design. Look at that. That's gorgeous. The way that it's just inlaid into the headstock like that. And you would think it would be like right up here, but that really works for that. And it's labeled as a custom on the truss rod cover. It looks like somebody has refretted it at one point in time, so that means he likely played this quite a bit. He's got a brass nut on it. You can see these tuners have been extensively used. Looks like they might need a little bit of a trimming though. But take a look at that. Two. Count them. Two toggle switches. It looks like we got 3-ply binding. I really don't know what the double toggles are doing. I would guess the bridge has also been replaced. They don't even have the top E string in the saddle. That's annoying. Like every single article or write-up or video I see of it, they don't talk about the double toggles. They talk about the headstock and the body shape. Here we go. Good old fretted Americana will tell us. So one of them's a 3-way selector on the treble horn, so the regular location, and the other one is a standby switch. Okay, so this one's regular. This one, is it like off, off, on, or something like that? I'm not sure. I guess I'll have to buy one of these one day and find out myself. But kind of a cool guitar, the one that not everybody knows about, the custom, or sometimes called the deluxe. But you'll notice, this headstock is very, you know, Fender-esque. At the same time, it also looks kind of Firebird. And you can totally tell that the Gibson Vegas series might have taken some inspiration from this design as well. So it's kind of cool how Trini's design has stayed relevant for so many years. This one sold for $22,500. And this was his personally owned and played one. He probably played it a lot if it was refretted. I'm surprised it didn't sell for even more than that. If you want it today, you'll have to offer him $33,000. Or you can go onto Reverb and get a mid-60s original for, you know, around $6,000. That just shows that there's not tons of interest in this model. That one has different spacing in the pickups, so they must have different specs from year to year. Next up is something I did not know existed. Is this another Gibson? Why did this one sell for $6,500, including the buyer's premium? It's actually the Heritage. That's kind of sneaky. So the Heritage must have wanted to take Trini Lopez and start making signature guitars for him. Now this is getting even closer to Fender territory. Maybe Fender just needs to make him one. But the Heritage actually looks pretty good on that. If you don't remember, the Heritage is made in the old Gibson Kalamazoo plant. They're basically the old guys that stayed behind to just start their own company instead of moving down to Nashville. So our headstock looks similar, maybe not quite as good without the point. There's something about the pointy headstock on that other one. But the inlays are where things get interesting. You still get the bound headstock, you get the bound ebony fretboard, you get the split diamond inlays, but take a look down here. They change it up. I don't know why. It looks a little bit strange, but I kinda like it at the same time. Not enough to spec my own guitar out like that, but interesting to see that they changed it up to the blocks at that point. But this one has a double height adjustment screw on them. Looks like he must have really liked those standby switches. They must be useful for him. But these F-holes are super bound. Like, that's a really thick binding. They stand out. That one's got a Schaller rolling bridge on it. They even reissued his badge, and they put the Heritage on the tailpiece. I kind of like that. So there we go, the Heritage version of the Custom. Was this actually a production model that I'm just not aware of? I'm not seeing one. I suppose it could have been like a super limited edition and they're just not showing up, but as far as the internet's concerned, I don't think that guitar existed. Let's see if they have anything to tell us. Alright, so it was custom built for Trini, made in Kalamazoo, Michigan. Unfortunately, not too much more of a story. Maybe they were trying to win him over and he's just like, nah, didn't like it enough. That would be an interesting one for a Heritage collector. But this one is kind of interesting. It's got a whole bunch of stuff going on. The reason I knew about this auction is because somebody I talked to quite a bit about guitars, he sent me this and he's like, hey, you can't talk about this until after the auction, but I want to win this guitar. I'm not sure if he got it. It might have went for more than he wanted to pay, but it sold for $9,375 after the buyer's premium. But this was actually labeled a TL-335 Trini Lopez. And this was actually a modern day prototype back from 2019. Now, I'm not sure if that was before or after the Gibson takeover under new management, because we eventually reissued the Trini Lopez model. You can actually buy them on Gibson's website right now. And oh my, I'm just now seeing this. That's not actually a white pickguard. That's just a film over top of it that you have to remove. Okay, so maybe this one's not quite as special as I thought. Currently on Gibson's website, you can order this one in an ebony finish or the 60s cherry. The headstock looks a little bit different, but it might just be the angles. So once you take that off, this is basically just a prototype of the new ones. So that'd be kind of cool to own. Selling for $9,000, I'd say that's pretty fair. I wish it had some sort of a good COA that said from Gibson that this was a prototype. I mean, sure, you're buying it from the estate of Trini Lopez, but maybe I'm just picky like that. When I buy a prototype to keep and hold as a collectible, I want it to say prototype somewhere. But those were all the Gibsons from the collection. So let's see what else Heritage sold for him. Like, his entire modernist estate. Welcome to the new Trogly's Estate channel, where we look at the world's most interesting houses and react to them blindly. You know, being in Northwest Ohio, I don't see trees like this around here. And a nice mountain backdrop, that's actually pretty cool. But this house, so far, I'm not all that impressed with it. It kind of looks like a bunker to me. But I like the white rocks out in his yard. Both large and small. Maybe it gets more homely once we get inside. Okay, that's interesting. You don't want people bugging you. You have your own outside garden, including a nice little water fountain here. Looks like he's got some of those solar lights. Some nice sunshades going on. Looks like we need a little bit of a repaint job right here, some cleaning up. Well, that could be a nice little place, but inside Trini's estate, he's got one of his signature guitars right over the fireplace. That doesn't look like a real wood-burning fireplace to me. And calling this modernistic, I would definitely say so. You've got some hardwood flooring going throughout, and then you switch over to more tiled material, separating the rooms quite nicely. And this mirror wall really opens up this entire space. Makes it look like there's a lot more space in that room than there truly is. Then we take a step back and you're entering into what looks like the dining room kitchen area. Kind of an interesting chandelier up here, with a table that matches the floors. And you got the mirror trickery going on here. That really helps bring out the natural light of the room though, because it comes from the windows, then reflects back. It really makes this home bright. As far as the kitchen, honestly, rather modest, I would say. We got a dishwasher here in the corner, even some fresh bananas, and a stand mixer. I'm not sure if those come with the estate or not. Looks like we've got a gas stove with a nice large double-doored refrigerator. But notice, really tall ceilings in this room. It really opens the whole place up. But now switching over to the master bedroom, we can see where Trini spent his nights at home. Once again, doing the mirror trick with the lighting. The master bath comes off to here, and then it looks like you got a way to get outside if you want to enjoy the amenities out there. Switching over to the second bedroom. At first, I was really confused, but it's just a mirror trick. It's not, you know, bedrooms right beside each other. You can see the pillows being reflected that are the same here. But tiled floor throughout most of the home. You'll definitely need those area rugs. Now this just looks like a straight up stock footage photo. I can't believe that's real. But a nice view of the in-ground pool that you'll need. And you got a nice little porch back here with an awning over top of it to keep you away from the hot sun's rays. But when you need to jump in the cool off in the pool, you can do that. Not a massive pool by any means. Looks like it could use some modernizations in here. But there's also a hot tub if you want it. Then from this angle of the pool, it looks a little bit nicer. And you can see his little abode right here called Casa Lopez. I don't know, as the buyer of this property, I would feel kind of bad taking that down because, you know, it's his home, but now it's your home. So you'll have to change it to whatever your last name is. But it does appear we have some sort of a diving board here to enjoy. Oh, nice. A sweet aerial view. Looks like you've got a couple of neighbors to worry about, but they've got very similar looking homes. So kind of industrial and modern looking towards the front, but you've got some nice private living space back here for the most part. The trees block out the neighbors from peeping on you. Looks like you're one of the very few people on the block that have grass, especially that green. But how much did Lopez's estate sell for? A little over $2 million, about $2.1 million. But we only saw about half the bedrooms there, and I don't even think we saw any of the baths. And it was built in 1961, and it had an opening bid of $1 million, and it's located in Palm Springs, California. As far as other things in his collection, looks like he had a Fender Princeton amp that sold for a pretty good amount. And lots of other memorabilia that I'll let you guys just look through this here real quick. Looks like he even had some stage-used clothing if you're into that type of stuff, including the leather boots. Alright, troglodytes, thank you for tuning in today. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe, and we will catch you tomorrow on the next episode. Take care.